Hello, Bob Holness bidding you welcome to a radio Christmas card, 45 minutes, during which regular listeners will recognise many of the personalities whom you hear throughout the year on BBC World Service. Well, here in Studio S6 in Bush House, London, they're gathered together to enjoy themselves and to share with you some of their thoughts about the festive season and the year ahead. So, to set the mood, let's hear from Skye. What a lovely version of Troika by Sky, starting our radio Christmas card. And first in line, I can see, immediately, he always starts his festivities early, is Paddy Feeny. Paddy, hello, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you. I was just trying to work out how long it is since we last met.
It must be generations, must be. Our paths have crossed many times. For those who don't know, and I can't believe there's anybody listening who doesn't know, you're the sports world man, the bearded wonder of the sporting world, right?
Thank you, sir.
Have you been around lately, around the world? Do you travel much?
I went to America during the summer to see my little granddaughters, and I did a series of programmes while I was over there at the same time. Went through Missouri and had a look through there.
Do you keep an eye on American sport when you're over there?
Yes, I do. I love it, actually. I love it. I go and see the baseball if I possibly can, and my wife is a tremendous fan of the Kansas City Royals, which, as you know, is one of the top teams in the United States of America.
Yeah, we all know that.
Yes, they come bottom of the league every damn time. No, I love it, actually. But I like America generally. I'm not one of those people who has a bash at America. I like it. I like the people. I like the whole scene, yeah.
You're looking very trendy with your sporting jersey. Makes me wonder whether you actually dress as a sportsman, but don't actually do any sports yourself.
Well, you've never tried to play indoor bowls against me, obviously. Or else you wouldn't have to ask. Simple as that. Well, I've got arthritis these days. I play outdoor bowls when it's the outdoor season, and during the indoor season, I play what we call indoor bowls.
So, does Christmas mean indoor bowling to you? Is that what you do over the festive spell?
Well, I would attempt to, except for the fact that all the 80 and 90-year-olds have already booked up the rink. So, no, unfortunately, I can't get on the green at all.
Now, when you're in good spirits, you've got a mince pie in one hand, a drink in the other, which is just as well, because I'm going to chat to Andy Kershaw now. So.
Oh, this is Andy Kershaw.
Yes, he's just come across. Hello, Andy.
I didn't know what you look like either. I've never seen you before,
but nice to meet you.
And you.
I'll leave you with Bob. This is Robert.
Paddy, have a happy 1990.
Thanks a lot, Bob.
All right, cheers. So, Andy, enjoying yourself?
Yes, certainly. Yeah, sure.
You're a travelling man. I know this. You do your world of music, but I often wonder whether you travel because of world of music. Is it something you want to push into the programme, or is it just a chief feature?
It's often the reason why I'll visit a country is because either I've heard so much good stuff from a place that I think I want to go and see how this music's performed and collect more of it. But in some cases, it's because I've heard nothing at all. And I think, well, it can't be devoid of music. There must be something going on in there. And that's often the case in places where perhaps running a record industry hasn't been a priority, you know, like if you've had a war or a revolution or something like that. So it's either because there's an awful lot or I've heard nothing and I want to find out.
Well, you've been to Mali, you've been to Louisiana, you've been to Bolivia, Chile. Have you got somewhere lined up next? And are you taking your recording equipment with you?
I am, yeah. I'm going to Haiti in the new year.
Are you? Mm. Well, that'll be interesting.
The Dominican Republic and Haiti, which are on the same island. And I'm going there because I spent a lot of money in recent months buying Haitian records, and I've not found one good one yet.
So you've got to get them yourself.
I'm sure they're in there somewhere. I'm going to have to go and find them, because I can't believe this country can produce nothing but bad music. There's got to be some good stuff.
On the technical side, what sort of equipment do you take?
I just take one of those little, I ain't like to say Sony, Walkman professionals, with a little mic, which looks a lot like a pistol. I don't want to go to somewhere really politically dicey carrying that one, because it looks like you're waving a pistol around in the crowd. But that's all it is. It's about the size of a paperback book.
Yeah. Well, Andy, enjoy the trip. I'm sure you'll have a wonderful time. And tell us next year where you've been over this coming year, because obviously you're always bouncing back and forth, as I say. We're going to listen to Elton John. Do you like Elton?
He's okay.
He's okay. Let's step into Christmas.
Enjoy yours.
Thank you. Welcome to my Christmas song. Well, Elton John's stepping into Christmas, and we step across to meet Hugh Prysor-Jones, one of several of the presenters on NewsHour. Hugh, hello, you're enjoying yourself, I can see.
Oh, certainly am, yes, yes, oh, thanks to the BBC, cheers.
You know, most radio people either glean all the information from radio news, or the exact reverse, they read all the newspapers. Do you do either or both?
Well, I don't do enough. I try and do both, and I try and do even more than that, but my conscience is permanently racked with guilt because the stacks of papers and magazines.
It's a daunting prospect, isn't it, in this country? There's so many newspapers, that's the trouble.
Well, that's right, and they get more and more every year. Yeah. And now Sunday newspapers are expanding, the constant production of new magazines, and, you know, most of them, well, they really aren't worth reading, but you've got to read them to find out.
So how do you relax?
Well, I've got a farm, and I farm whenever I can.
Wasn't it nice to say, I've got a farm? Isn't that lovely? Do you farm?
Yes, yes. I've got a flock of sheep. I've got rather too many sheep at the moment, and I have a cider apple orchard. I make my own cider. Just started, be on the market in a couple of years. And I used to have some cattle, but had a bit of difficulty there, and they had to go, because I love cattle.
Hmm. Where is it? Where is the farm?
It's down in West Dorset, near Bridport.
A long way from the likes of Africa and America, and I know you're well acquainted with those places. Have you ever spent Christmas over there?
No, I've spent Christmas in America.
Have you?
And I spent Christmas in Germany. But I usually try to get home for Christmas. I'm not always at home on Christmas Day because, I mean, until about 3 years ago, I routinely worked on Christmas Day. Mm. And then I finally got fed up with it and, you know, that was it.
Well, Hugh, thank you very much for joining us. It's been super seeing you. And all the very best of the luck on the news side as well. Back to the farm as I cross over to Barbara Myers, who's standing here looking healthy. She should, of course, because of health matters and outlook. Everybody will recognise you for that. Do you practice what you preach regarding health, Barbara?
Well, I suppose I do. I don't want to sound pious at this time of the year. But I suppose I do try and keep healthy. I'm pretty well blessed with good health. And I like to feel that I'm going to be healthy for as long as possible. So, yes, I limit myself, I suppose, to what I eat. Don't go madly overboard. And I'm quite keen on being reasonably exercise conscious and so on.
Well, I was going to mention that. Does sport play a part in keeping healthy?
I love sport. I play squash, I play golf, and I play tennis. And I play with my two young sons. And that's just the best way, of course, chasing around, kicking a football in the garden with them.
You've got the best of both worlds in one sense, because the practical thing is health matters, where you can talk about just what you've been mentioning. The other side is keeping in touch with what's going on through Outlook. Are you a great reader? Do you read many newspapers?
Oh, well, I'm certainly happiest when I feel very much on top of the stories that we're covering. And so, yes, I like all journalists, I read the papers, of course. And I read the books too. We often, as you well know, talk to authors. And actually, it's a great privilege, I think, to have time to read some of the new books that are published. And yes, I have a train journey to and from the studio. I live in Brighton on the south coast.
Yeah, that's useful.
Yes, well, that's at least an hour. And on a bad day, I can be on a train for 2 hours. And so I get chance to read quite extensively then.
So what sort of a Christmas is it for you? One with your feet up reading or one jumping up and down doing exercise?
Well, it's going to be jumping up and down because Christmas, as you know, is for children, and my children are already very excited about Father Christmas arriving and all the fun and games that we'll be playing. So it'll be a pretty active Christmas, and it will be a child's view of Christmas, which is the best.
Seasonal greetings then, Barbara Myers, to you and your family, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Another good old favourite from Christmas, Good King Wenceslas, by The Players, and one of the players of all types of music, both in Britain and on world services, Ken Bruce, of course, the Ken Bruce Show we all know and love. Ken, you're a dyed-in-the-wool Scot. Do you celebrate Hogmanay?
Well, all Scots celebrate Hogmanay in one degree or another, but since I've came down to London, you see, they don't celebrate it in the same way.
No, they don't.
They do in Scotland.
That's true.
In Scotland, you would walk around from everybody's house, go knocking on doors and just inviting yourself in, having a drink, and a little bit of shortbread or black bun or something like that.
Mm.
But if you try that in London, it's some very odd looks indeed. Yeah. I've come in for a drink. Go away. And that's one of the nicer things you hear.
Yes, they do a spot of first footing, don't
that's
they?
That's the term.
Yes. Exactly. Somebody tall and dark, which excludes both of us. Of
indeed,
course.
I'm sort of short and grey these days.
Well, I'm grey. And they have to knock on the door and they get all sorts of nice things done to them or something.
Well, traditionally, it's supposed to be a tall, dark, handsome stranger who walks through, who's the first person through your door after the turn of the year. So you do try to find somebody who fills that bill. But of course in Scotland everybody's much shorter than they are in England. We are wireless. So I was tall in Scotland.
Yes. Do you travel for Christmas? Have you travelled for Christmas?
No, never. I've always been at home for Christmas. New Year I have travelled far and wide for the BBC.
Have you?
They used to make me do programmes over New Year. staying sober until 2 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, that was
a remarkable feat. But professionalism saw me through.
Mm.
And we used to do live dancing and entertainment programmes for the BBC right through until 2 a.m. And then I would celebrate the new year.
Yeah.
But I couldn't first foot anybody.
Ah. Well, standing right over your left shoulder, just behind you, if you move aside, is David Allan. I wonder if he's travelled. David, have you ever travelled to Nashville?
Oh, many times. It's about the only place in America I've been to.
Is it?
12 times to Nashville and virtually nowhere else.
You're
very
joking,
sad.
Really?
It is awful, isn't it?
But, it's a bit restricting.
It is.
You didn't ever think of going elsewhere while you were there?
Well, it's the time aspect. I was usually there on the job, as it were, for the BBC. They're very kindly paid the airfare, so who was I to refuse?
Oh,
but
absolutely.
I have been to California, actually. My sister-in-law lives there, but mainly little old Nashville.
Mm. You're more closely associated with country music than anything else because of country style. Is that your exclusive taste in music? Do you like any other sort of music?
It is dreadful now that there's so much happening in country music. I tend to listen to nothing but country music. It makes me very boring, and I realise...
I find that a shame.
It is. I think that's one of the things for the future. I shall have to widen my taste. But there's so much happening. You've got to keep up with it if you do the programmes. And night and day, drive the whole family mad, it's country music. Dreadful, isn't it?
Well, enjoy country music right through 1990, won't you?
There's some wonderful stuff coming out.
Is there?
A lot of it's on the World Service. Country
yes,
stuff.
Of course. And Ken, you enjoy 1992. I know you will.
Oh,
you enjoy everything,
love
don't
it.
You?
I enjoy every year, and I'll enjoy listening to country style as well. Because if he's plugging his programme, I might as well plug it as well.
Oh, why not?
Very nice.
And I know you'll enjoy, I don't know whether David will, listening to Bing Crosby. It wouldn't be the same without Bing, would it?
No,
right.
Said the night wind to the little lamb, do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
Way up.
Yes, very familiar Bing Crosby number, Do You Hear What I Hear? Not exactly the sort of music our next guest would play for relaxation, I suspect. Edward Greenfield, hello, nice to see you again.
Very nice to see you, but I love Bing Crosby.
Do you?
I don't know that I play him that often, because I've got a lot of other things to play. The records have been coming out better than ever this
year.
Oh,
it's because of CDs, of course. They're just swamping the market, aren't they?
Who would have believed that so many would have come out?
Do you play at home? Do you play music at home a lot?
Well, I learn for reviewing sake to sample rather than to play whole things. But then when I play whole things, particularly on CD, a classic recording of the past, there's nothing more wonderful than that.
Yes, Music Review is a very popular programme for classical music lovers, but I wonder, does it grate with you having to play music you don't particularly like sometimes?
Well, I always try and appreciate all the time. I mean, I think if I was really honest, perhaps some of the nasty modern rubbish. but usually even that really says something to me. And you get such marvellous people, ones that I've been interviewing, who perform these amazing works. And they are super people. And I think the electricity of their personality comes over in even this outlandish music.
Can I tell you, the enthusiasm that you're talking with now comes over in Music Review as well. You're very enthusiastic about music.
Well, of course
it's your life, really, isn't it?
Oh, yes, yes, I live for it. My religion.
I wonder if you're in favour of the popular approach to music, such as that displayed by Gordon Clyde in The Pleasure's Yours. Hello, Gordon, how are you?
Hello, Bob.
You're nice enjoying
to
yourself,
you.
Too.
Aye.
You're a popular music man, and I wonder whether that offends or pleases Edward. What would you say?
Well, it doesn't offend. I think you can be both, you know. You can be authoritative.
From what Edward has just said, that he likes being Crosby. You see, I gave 3 cheers for that.
Yes.
I thought my taste was somewhere between Bing Crosby and the sort of music that Edward has to review and talk about.
Hmm.
But this is, you see, the programme, Pleasure's Yours, it spoils me because it allows me to play the sort of music that I like, which is middle-of-the-road classical music, nothing too esoteric.
Hmm.
I don't often listen at home because I get the chance to when I do the programme. But I did sit down last night and I listened to the whole of Bach's Goldberg Variations.
Good.
I'm saying this for Edward's benefit.
Yes, of course.
Which I'd never heard through before. And I must say, it was just magic.
Yeah.
Just let it waft.
Did you have to be in the mood? Did you have to sit down on your own and listen to it?
Yes, yes, I was in the mood. And I'm very glad I've discovered it. And I discovered a lot of things through my programme.
Gordon, Edward, have a smashing 1990. Thank you for joining us at the party. I think both of you are going to appreciate this piece of music. It's by Michala Petri with the Westminster Abbey Choir and the National Philharmonic.
Like it already.
Here's the old favourite ding-dong merrily on eye. And here's someone who rings a bell. Sarah Ward.
Hello.
Hello, Sarah. How are you?
Very well, Bob.
Good
to see you.
We'll be talking in a moment. We'll be hearing from Charles Alexander about jazz. Now, it occurred to me, because I can see him across the other side of the room there, I'd ask you first whether jazz crops up in multitrack 3. I don't get a chance to listen, so I don't really know.
It does crop up. Not frequently, but occasionally we have talked to some interesting jazz musicians, including a couple of the really great young saxophone players. And so jazz, certainly, and I love it personally.
Yeah, how wide is your appreciation of music? Does it stretch from jazz to popular classics, or do you go even further over?
Right the way across the board, Bob. Yeah, it's
much
really hard
me.
To explain this to people, but I just love music. I'm in love with music.
Me too, yeah.
I find that I listen to an awful lot of different kinds of music. I've been, in the last couple of years, rather particularly interested in world music, if you like, and that's from Africa and from Latin America and so on. And I think perhaps that interest stems from the fact that I was born and brought up in Kenya and in East Africa and took music for granted when I was there. You would hear songs being sung in the road, in workplaces, all over the place. You just took them for granted. But it's obviously got into my blood somewhere
along. Having lived in Africa myself, I know exactly what you mean. Yes, it's there all the time, isn't it?
Yes.
Anyway, back home, back to this Christmas. Busy one for you?
It's a working Christmas.
Oh, is it?
A bit like Santa Claus, actually. You know, I'm sort of climbing down chimneys and running around reading news bulletins, doing all sorts of things.
Getting up early in the morning?
Very early, 4:15
in the
morning.
Oh, you poor thing.
Yes.
Oh, well, this is a chance for you to relax.
And I'm enjoying it enormously.
Yes, we'll have a super 1990, won't you?
I will indeed, and I'd like to wish everybody listening to the BBC World Service the happiest of New Year's.
Sarah Ward, thank you very much indeed. Cheers.
Bye-bye, Bob.
And while we've been talking, Charles Alexander has, in fact, edged across here. Hello, Charles. Nice to
Hello,
see you.
Hello, Bob.
Our annual meeting.
Yes, indeed.
Jazz scene UK. A good scene in 1989?
I think so. I think it's really been the year of the tenor sax players.
Do you?
Some of the players that have been coming up for the last 2 or 3 years have really consolidated their position in the scene. I think of players like Courtney Pine, just brought a new album out, A Vision's Tale, in which he refers back to earlier traditions of saxophone playing, which is rather nice. Andy Shepherd, who just received an award for Best Album of the Year and Best Instrumentalist. His album, Introductions in the Dark, I think is very good.
It's a very hopeful scene in this country, isn't it, that we've got young players like that coming
up. Yes, and some of the ones that we know about are already on album are excellent, and there's others coming up that haven't yet recorded. I think Jason Ribello is a young pianist who's been working with Tommy Smith and various other musicians. He is the next one to, I think, make a big impact.
Yeah. Have you got any concerts coming up in the future? I mean, this 1990s coming up, I know you're involved with mounting concerts and tours and things.
Well, I think the next thing that I'm involved in is in Czechoslovakia.
Oh.
And I'm intending to take a Scottish band there this time, the John Ray Collective, who have issued a cassette, and I think they're just about to issue an album, the first proper album, really. And they're very good young musicians. That should be quite exciting.
Now, I know you play and teach guitar, so I'm going to play a little bit of a record which you may just recognise, and I want to come back to you afterwards.
I'm dreadful and blind.
See what you have to say about it. Plinkety-plunk it sounds now. It was a very important record of its time, wasn't it? Because Les Paul, I suppose, did more for the guitar than anybody else ever did.
He's brilliant. Yeah. There's a wonderful movie about Les Paul called, I think, The Wizard from Winnetka, in which he shows his original solid guitars, takes them apart, puts them together, shows you the multi-track recording machines that he linked together. And he's an innovator, technically, and musically as well. Brilliant player, still.
Charles, it's lovely to see you. I'll see you again next year, I suppose.
I hope so, Bob. Very nice.
Have a super 1990, won't you?
And to you as well. Thank you very much indeed.
And we move across to the presentation department now to meet Alison Roper. Alison, are you enjoying yourself? You look as though you
are. Very much, yes. I'm trying to keep off the alcoholic drink, though.
I can see that. It's a pity it's not television. That's a lovely, lovely sweatshirt.
Yes, well, it's Minnie Mouse, and my daughter refuses to wear any Minnie Mouse things because it's girlish, and she's a tomboy, so I wear them instead.
What's your favourite source of entertainment over Christmas? What do you like doing?
Over Christmas, I think, well, eating, to be honest, is a great luxury. And watching television and reading.
There are Yugoslavian connections in your family.
Yes.
Is it your mother that's Yugoslavian?
Yes, my mother was from Belgrade, and she worked in Bush House in the Yugoslav section years and years ago, just after the war.
So have you spent a Serbo-Croat Christmas?
Not for a very, very long time. In fact, our Serbo-Croat Christmas is in January. It's not in December.
Oh, really?
We're 2 weeks further forward.
Yes.
Yes, I have done, but not for a long time.
I should say one word to you before I pass across and pick up on that, having spent Christmas overseas, and that's Dovigenia.
Oh, Dovigenia for you.
As we go across to Brian Empringham. Brian, you were in Jordan, I think, weren't you, this time last year, spending Christmas?
Yes, I was indeed. I spent 3 months out there training the newsreaders and announcers on Jordan radio and television, which meant we had Christmas in the Middle East, and a white Christmas as well. It snowed on Christmas Day.
Oh, did it?
And a lovely Boxing Day. I remember driving down the Jordan Valley for our obligatory swim, or should I say float, in the Dead Sea, and listening to a riveting programme all about angels on the World Service, which was absolutely smashing. It was just the right place to be listening to it.
Yes, we do a lot of that, sending people like yourself across to do just what you did in Jordan. Did you enjoy it altogether?
I did enjoy it very much.
A useful exercise.
Yes, it was a useful exercise. I learnt a lot from it.
I
hope the staff at Jordan Radio and Television did as well. If you're listening, I shall want to report. It was a fascinating exercise. Jolly hard work, but more than anything, I was totally overwhelmed by the hospitality and the response. Everybody looked after me so well. It was a marvellous time.
Well, are you enjoying your homebound Christmas this year?
Yes, I shall be working for some of it. I don't mind working at Christmas. I think there's something very special about working at Christmas time. Usually people who are listening to the radio, perhaps this applies more to a domestic audience than an overseas audience, but usually the people who are listening at Christmas are listening because they want to, perhaps because they are on their own.
Yeah.
And it's nice to be there and share the Christmas with them.
Mm. And I think that about the people who are listening right now. Wherever you are, thank you very much indeed. Alison Roper and Brian Empringham, and do have a happy and successful 1990, both of you, won't you?
Thank you, Bob.
All the best.
It's Christmas time and time for a carol, time to sing about the little king, to fill the bowl and roll out the barrel, have ourselves a fling.
One of my favourite Carpenter's tracks. It's Christmas time. Now, who should come across to the microphone but Malcolm Billings? Malcolm, I haven't seen you in the lift this year.
No, we only meet at Christmas time.
That's right. Well, it's a good time to meet, isn't it? Seven Seas still going strong?
Yes, Seven Seas is still in the schedules.
Yeah, it's been a bit adventurous, hasn't it? You've been ploughing through old shipwrecks and things this year.
Yes, well, one of the things that Seven Seas can do now is not only to explore what's going on across the sea, but underneath the sea as well.
Mm.
And program we made earlier this year in the summer was on the world's oldest shipwreck, which is in the Mediterranean along the Turkish coast.
When did it take place, do you know?
Well, the shipwreck took place over 3,000 years ago. 3,500.
Is there anything left?
Well, yes, there is. And that's the exciting thing. You go along to this spot on the Turkish coast, and you can tell where the shipwreck is, because on the sheer cliff, the archaeologists have built tents and huts where they live during the summer. And then they dive 170 feet down, almost to the bottom of the Mediterranean, to find this wreckage.
How amazing. Have they found anything important?
And they have. Well, they found bits of the ship.
Incredible.
I mean, that's incredible, isn't it?
Oh, goodness gracious me.
34 centuries to find bits of ship, so they can tell how it was made.
I've got to cut you short, because I see someone else coming up I want to talk to, Julie Lloyd. Will you be keeping people in touch through Seven Seas with what's going on in this shipwreck?
Indeed, yes. Yeah. Next year, perhaps we'll have another report on
year-by-year report, yeah.
Yes.
Yes, and that other person is Julie Lloyd. Julie, of course, she's presented lots of religious features on World Service. And, Julie, you start, don't you, a new job as executive producer of religious programmes on World Service next year.
I do indeed.
When does it start exactly?
I begin on the 2nd of January, and I have to say I'm rather filled with awe at what a large job it is.
That's a fine way to end a decade. How did you start the decade? Can you remember?
Well, one of the most important things for me at the beginning was in December 1981, when I joined the Teze community, which is an ecumenical community that's based in France, for its international meeting held in London. And we began the new year of 1982 with this marvellous watch night service in which one could take part with all these young people from all over the world in making a commitment to try to live the next year expressing God in the world and trying to live out the message of his truth.
When does Christmas itself start for you? Can you tell us?
Christmas begins for me on Christmas Eve, when we go along to our local church for the most beautiful festival of nine lessons and carols. And that's very much a time to just stop and think a little about the Christmas message. And I remember the best sermon I ever heard one Christmas was by a priest who said, don't let's forget that the Bethlehem message of the Nativity is still being lived out where people are turned away and are poor. And he reminded us in 1984 of the people who had no homes in Ethiopia. And I feel that we can't really think about Christmas without remembering those people who may be starving shortly if we don't do something to help now. And also the many young people who will spend Christmas sleeping rough in cardboard boxes out on the streets of London.
Absolutely. Julie, thank you very much indeed. And good luck for 1990. I hope everything goes well. Good luck to you, Malcolm.
Thank you.
Good luck with the shipwreck.
Thank you, Bob.
Julie, something you'll appreciate, a piece of music coming up next. Gabriel's Message by Sting.
The angel Gabriel from heaven came. His wings as drifted snow, his eyes as flame.
Well, Sting with Gabriel's Message. And walking across the room, I come across a mix of people, a mega mix of people.
Yeah.
Two, in fact, John Sugar and Annie Bristow. John, you're known on my little piece of paper as a roving reporter. To what extent do you rove?
Well, I tend to sort of pick the unusual, Bob, to go and rove around. I mean, this week I went down to Bath and met a witch who was involved in putting an exhibition of photographs about the inexplicable.
Oh.
And she's a fascinating woman. I mean, she's got her own pet poltergeist and that sort of thing. So I sort of tend to sort of rove around things that are inexplicable, unusual. I mean, I often meet sort of aliens and people from outer space, that sort of thing. But then again, that's not even a nutshell. I mean, there are other things.
Yes, of course, there would be. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, one has to get about a bit. But I do like sort of moving about.
And do you like meeting people over Christmas, or are you a solitary soul at Christmas?
Christmas. Well, I tend to. I think that everybody at some time or another has to meet somebody at Christmas because it's just not on sit at home.
Whether you like it or not.
Yes, you have to. I mean, it's in the contract, isn't it? You have to go out.
Of course, of course. Yeah, I know somebody else who's a traveller, and that's Annie Bristow. You like travelling, don't you, Annie?
Yes. I've just got to add here that John is the most inexplicable thing, of course, I've ever met.
Slight exaggeration there, I think.
You holidayed in Aquitaine, France, earlier in the year, and more recently you were in Crete, weren't
yes.
you?
Yes.
Is it sheer joy or business that takes you to these places?
Well, I mean, obviously it's to go for a break from Megamix. No, it's not that much of a strain. It's great, really. It's a bit of both in a way, really. Funnily enough, John and I were just talking a bit earlier on about the fact that we always are basically overseas. We're trying to imagine somebody who is our listener who's in another part of the world. It is an imaginary listener. And mine's in Ghana, and yours is?
Mine's invariably the Mong Hill tribes of Thailand.
Right, and somebody else who works on the program. Their listener is up the Limpopo River.
Oh, really? Why should yours be in Ghana particularly? Is that where you get most letters from, perhaps?
Well, we have a lot of listeners in Ghana and in Africa as a whole who write to us. And with many parts of the world, Africa, India, the Far East, it's important that if we're reflecting Britain and things that are happening here that are concerning young people, that we do it in a way that everybody else can understand.
Mm.
And if I was listening in Africa, you know, I might not always quite understand exactly the things that were happening in Britain. So I try and focus on what that person would ask, what questions my listener in Ghana would ask about this, and how I can best do a piece for Megamix, which will be as clear as it possible.
Well, that's a very good explanation. What about your explanation for your tribe, John?
Well, ultimately, I think that the reason I picked the Mong Hill tribes of Thailand is because it's probably the most strangest sounding group I could think of. I mean, the Mong Hill tribes of Thailand, something rather magical and mystical about it, Bob. But also, a very good friend of mine went and spent 18 months with them and came back telling me these amazing stories about what these people got up to and how they dealt with things like illness and how spiritual they were. And I thought, God, I'd love to go there one day. So I just sort of thought, yes, I mean, one day I will go there.
Yeah.
I'm sure about it.
I'm sure you will, yes.
And
whether they want you or not.
That's right.
Right, this Christmas,
yes.
Are you busy? Are you meeting people? Are you sitting at home? What are you doing?
Well, I should be spending Christmas with my parents. It's obligatory, really. I mean, I've tried to get out of this sort of thing, but unfortunately they won't let me. So I'll spend it with my parents, and then the rest of it I'll just be sort of in a drunken haze with my girlfriend, I hope.
Annie, what about you?
I will not be in a drunken haze, good heavens. I do the trips to my parents before Christmas, actually, so that I can go and hide away, read lots, watch lots of films on television, eat far too much, and just generally relax.
Well, Annie Bristow and John Sugar, thank you for joining us.
Not
and
sure
do have a very successful and peaceful 1990, won't you?
Thanks a lot.
Thank
Cheers.
You.
And I hope you've enjoyed hearing from some of the many voices you regularly hear on BBC World Service. And I hope the Christmas spell is a pleasant one for you as we prepare to go into 1990. Now from the producer of a Radio Christmas Card, Dave Tate, and from me, Bob Holness, compliments of the season, have a happy and peaceful new year. as we leave you with a Christmas song by Sean Phillips.
He came in the way that good things come, with the light shining in his eyes. And most people thought it was another little babe that wrinkled up his face and cried. And then one wise man, two wise men, three wise men coming from afar.